Sit back, relax, and get out your phones because it's time to get your pet questions answered. Hi, today we are joined by Gracie and by Dr. Katie Spaulding from Dakin Humaine Society to get you the answers to your pet questions. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Spaulding.
Thank you for having me.
So I think we have our first caller on the line. It's Susan. Are you there, Susan?
Yes, I am.
What is your question for our doctor?
My question is, recently I had a 7-month-old kitten pass away from FIP. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, I have an adult cat that is 5 years old that was tested as well, and her levels were high. And my question to you, because it's such a rare kitty disease, when I can get another cat in my household?
Okay, well, FIP is kind of a tricky disease because it's considered contagious, but it's not directly contagious. What it is, it's a coronavirus, which can cause diarrhea in most cats, but in some cats it actually undergoes some kind of mutation and causes FIP with clinical signs and can cause death. Usually it does. Younger cats tend to be more affected. If your other cat was tested, I'm assuming he was tested for the coronavirus itself, but I'm not clear about that. Usually they will be exposed, but that doesn't necessarily mean he's going to develop the FIP disease. And so when to bring another cat into the home, it's not very clear. It's not, like I said, directly contagious, so the coronavirus itself would be, but whether or not another cat would develop FIP is unknown.
Okay. And basically the kitty that I had purchased the Persian kitten from, I'm wondering she's willing to either give me my money back pretty much or get another kitten, and I'm willing to give it a chance because I know it's such a rarity. So again, maybe that's just a personal question, but I was wondering what your thoughts on.
Yeah, there is some kind of genetic component to it. So if you're getting another kitten from the same breeder,
yep,
that kitten might also be more predisposed to coming down with the same clinical signs as opposed to a kitten from just the general population. So it might be more at risk, but again, it's hard to say whether or not it would definitely come down with it or not.
Okay. And can you test that through feces, or is it a blood test from a little cat?
The test for the coronavirus, it can be through feces. You can also check for antibodies through blood, but just because it comes up positive for being exposed to that virus doesn't necessarily mean that he's going to get the FIP. So there's a lot of cats that would test positive. In most cats, coronavirus just causes diarrhea and it's nothing to worry about. But in some cats, it does mutate and cause the deadly form of FIP.
Okay, because the kitty that I was...
Thanks so much for your call, Susan.
Thank you.
Hey, now, Dr. Spaulding, we have a question from Facebook. Andrea was wondering the best ways to protect short-haired dogs during the winter. And is this a good example that we have with Gracie right here?
Yeah, that is a good example. So Gracie has short hair. She was actually shaved by us because she came in with lice. Mm-hmm. And she has short hair. She is wearing a little coat on cold days. She was shivering when she came in.
She was.
She might be a little nervous too. But the best way to keep pets safe during the winter from the elements would be not to let them outside for prolonged periods of time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we always recommend indoor dogs. So, but if they do have to go outside for bathroom purposes or whatever, especially short-haired dogs like this, little jackets or sweaters, they even have little boots for dogs to keep their feet safe.
So it's stylish and functional.
Yeah.
Well, Dr. Spaulding, thank you so much. Stick around, okay, because we're going to have you here all show along. So you will have a chance to get your pet questions answered live on the air when we come back. You can just call us, 413-377-2001, and you could have a chance to ask Dr. Spaulding a question yourself. And coming up to welcome back to Mass Appeal. So, put down your remote controls, pick up your phones, and call because it's time to get your pet questions answered. Dr. Katie Spaulding is sticking around, and we're going to start with a Facebook question. We have people on the line, but first, I think it's important to talk about, because it's winter time and dogs are getting cold, if Brosnan wrote in and said her boxer Elliot needs to put on weight, what's the best way to put on weight in dogs?
So, most dog foods, when you buy them, will have a recommended feeding guide on the bag. sometimes that kind of overshoots, but there is a way to calculate out the caloric needs for a dog to gain weight. Basically, if you feed enough food, your dog should be gaining weight. If that is not happening, I would be concerned about some underlying medical condition. Mm-hmm. And so for her in particular, I would have her consult with a veterinarian, make sure there's nothing going on with the dog that is making him not able to gain weight. But if you follow the recommendations for feeding, maybe throwing in an extra meal and breaking up the meals over the course of the day, that should help.
That's good. Well, thank you so much. These are only general guidelines, by the way, folks at home. So, you know, if we have questions, people should always defer to their veterinarians, right? But for now, we have Janet on the phone. Hey, Janet.
Hello, Dr. Spaulding.
Hi.
Thank you for taking my call. I have two kitty cats. They're brother and sister, and they each weigh between 18 and 20 pounds. They have problems with constipation. They're 10 years old. My veterinarian told me to go ahead and give lactulose, 10 grams per 15 milliliters of solution. And it's very hard to do this. My husband and I have been trying to do this for about a year. And we give it with a little dropper. I was wondering, could I give them a small dose of Marilax, which is a laxative for people?
What do you think about that?
I wouldn't recommend giving anything for people unless you have been directly advised to do so by your veterinarian.
I see.
With cats with constipation, has your vet talked to you about having them lose some weight?
Yes, he has. It's primarily our male cat who is long-haired, and he has more of a problem than our female cat.
Okay.
I mean, to the point where our cat had to be put to sleep and then basically give it an enema to clean him out. And we don't want to put the poor thing through that again.
So right.
I'm trying to do this with the lactulose, but it's not working very well. So
okay.
I'm sorry to be revealing such a hard question, but I'm really at a dilemma because my husband's in the hospital and I'm here alone, and this has been going on for a couple weeks, so... Actually, the constipation problem has been going on for almost a year.
Okay. And constipation in kitties can be kind of a tricky thing, and sometimes it's a matter of playing around with different diets, making sure they're well hydrated. Sometimes you need to add in fiber to their diet. The lactulose should help.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I know it can be very difficult to give medication to a cat, and that sounds like what
sure
you're
is.
Having problems with. So I would talk to your vet again about maybe recommending some different kinds of food that you could try if you're still having issues. Because it's a long-haired cat, if it's an issue with him ingesting hair, maybe keeping him well-groomed, maybe even getting him shaved so that he's not ingesting as much hair could help, too.
I see.
Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate your help.
Hey, and if you want to take Gracie home, you're more than welcome to. She's available at Dakin.
Okay. Thank you, you guys. Your program is wonderful.
Oh, thank you. You are wonderful, too.
I needed that. Okay.
Have a good one.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Hey, and thanks. We're going to do one more segment with you. How's that sound, Dr. Spaulding?
Great.
Good. So you stick around, Gracie. You stick around because you are adorable. And now I'm going to toss it over to Ashley, who's with Chef Roger from Atkins Farm. Hey, Ash.
Thanks so much, Seth.
Yeah. So we have one caller on the line, one more segment left. So everybody, pick up your phones and give us a call really quick, though. We have Paul on the line. How's it going, Paul?
Good afternoon, Seth. How are you, my friend?
I'm not too shabby. And yourself?
Good. I want to thank you and the doctor. You had a cat on Mass Appeal several months ago. It had a feline immune deficiency, and I want to share with you and the doctor that this cat is the most lovable and endearing cat I've ever had. Something that seems precocious or a tendency to be slow to decide, you don't even think about it once the cat's home. It's really been a home run. The question's actually about the cat.
Oh, yeah.
This is funny. This is the personality. The cat will be hanging and cuddling, purring from ear to ear. I'll be in a private area in my house watching TV. The TV will come on, and you'll hear the voices say Ashley Baylor or Laura Hutchinson or even Ashley Cole. And after years of meeting these guys at the events, I always jokingly say hi. The cat's eyes doctor turns black. Dilation, the nails come out, and it flips out. It's like it starts having a little seizure of jealousy. And the behavior modifier, we put him in his kennel, didn't work. I remove him from the bedroom. That seems to be the only thing that works. I was wondering if you had any suggestions on that.
Dr. Spaulding, suggestions?
Cat behavior can be a tricky thing. We do have, at Dakin, we have a behavior helpline. And I would refer you to that. You could call 413-781-4000, extension 129, and they might be able to refer you to some trainers and people who specialize in cat behavior, and that might be the answer that you're looking for.
I really hope your cat doesn't dislike Ashley Baylor, Ashley Cole, Laura Hutchinson, all of them. They're nice people.
I think they're wonderful. Hey, Seth, to add to your point, victimization requires acceptance, and we shouldn't let people rent space in our head. Remain true and peaceful to our inner ear.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Paul.
Thanks, guys.
So we have one more question, and it's about dry skin, wintertime, getting itchy. Dogs get it, people get it too. What are some things that you can do maybe if you start seeing dandruff on your dog?
First, I would suggest you see a veterinarian because there are lots of reasons for skin problems in both dogs and cats. One being fleas, and that can cause itchiness, and sometimes you see it manifest as dry skin just like any itchy disorder. Mm-hmm. Allergies, at this time of year, the heat is usually kicking on, dry air. Environmental allergies are still a big problem in the fall. So finding the underlying cause for the itchiness is what you should do first, and then, you know, have your vet prescribe either flea medication or antibiotics if there's an infection or whatever is going on.
I have a stupid question. Is there such a thing as like a dog moisturizer?
There are conditioning baths and things that you can use, and there's lots of products available. So,
hey, we have one last question coming in. It's Rachel. Hello, Rachel.
Hi, how are you?
Not too shabby.
My question is, I have a 5-year-old dog that constantly keeps licking my kids.
Okay. That's a bad thing in your world, right?
Well, you know, it annoys my kids. I didn't know, like, does that mean anything or how to stop that or...
Again, that sounds more of like a behavior issue. So if you wanted to call the behavior helpline, again, that number is 413-781-4000, extension 129. And there are trainers and behaviorists that can address those kind of issues.
My dog used to do that to me a lot. My mom has this theory that it's because I have salt, you know, people have salt on their skins, and maybe dogs like that.
Yeah, or maybe the kids are sticky.
Maybe your kids are full of honey. Thank you so much. And unfortunately, we're out of time, but I think we should mention really quick, you can adopt Gracie. She's absolutely adorable, and you can adopt her from Dakin today. Dr. Spaulding, thank you so much for stopping by and answering
our questions.
Thanks for having me. And coming up on...